Brian, can you believe what Don is saying? I believe that Aaron Boone is the manager of the year. I thought that he got rooked yesterday.
Well, I'd say it's the competition. I thought Aaron Boone did a fantastic job, clearly, and I think we all do. But at the same time, that doesn't take away from the great jobs that Baldelli and Kevin Cash and the manager in Oakland. I mean, it's a stiff competition. That voting process, there's a lot of really quality candidates.
So. But do you believe that there's an anti-Yankee bias? Well, the Yankees have a high payroll, so he should win. And my point in this, Brian, is. Yeah, you guys have a high payroll. Most of it was on the IL last year.
I mean, I don't know. I don't really focus as much to that. The only consolation is that Aaron's got, for instance, and I'm not saying Aaron's disappointed, is that we found a way to get past Minnesota, and our ultimate goal is to win a championship, and that's what we're all in this for. So I don't think Aaron's in it for, the accolades or the Manager of the Year award or what have you, and they're nice when they come. But there's a lot of reasons that go into it. I think Baldelli is deserving, just like I thought Aaron Boone was deserving and Kevin Cash would be deserving. But it's, I guess for those people who know Baldelli and, they know how really an amazing person he is and a tremendous selection as a manager that Minnesota made, that I think probably speaking from the Yankees, you're happy for Rocco Baldelli, you're disappointed for Booney, but it's hard to be too disappointed when you know how really good Rocco really is too at the same time. So it's just it's a beauty pageant, and whoever but there's a lot of amazing quality people that were in competition for it. I thought Aaron did an amazing job, and I don't think he could have done anything more than he did do, and that's all you can ask.
All right, now you got an off season, and I wonder how you look at it. Do you look at it and say, we had a team that was good enough to win a championship, we just didn't? Or do you look at the off season as, we came up short, and now I have to figure out a way to spackle those holes so that doesn't happen again?
Well, both. I mean, I think that our team was capable of a championship. We were in it with a legitimate chance to win it. I thought at Aaron Boone's postseason press conference, I thought he articulated it really the most accurately when he said, we weren't a player or two away, we were a play or two away from playing in the World Series. And that's what we truly believe. But that the job at hand, though, is, again, as we find ourselves trying to strategize for 2020, is how can we improve on this roster? We won 100 games 2 years ago, 103 this year. It's hard to improve a roster that has those type of wins, but that doesn't diminish the need or the effort and the ability to try to find a way to improve upon it. And so we're going into this winter looking to continue to focus on our rotation. I think as is, we still have a very strong rotation if we have all people that are healthy and in terms of Tanaka and Severino and Paxton and Herman, although his situation hasn't been resolved yet, Montgomery's returning back into play. I think Jay Happ pitched much better or more representative of what Jay Happ's capabilities are the last 2 months of the season. Looking for a bounce back from him. And then we have some young kids pushing up the top, but that doesn't preclude us from entering the trade and free agent market of how can we connect, if we can connect with some, really impactful talent towards the front of the rotation. The bullpen's still our strength. It's one of the best in the business in baseball, and we've got a really group of talented offensive-minded players that have helped us impact that win column. So I think right on paper, coming out of the chute, we're really, really good, and it's our job to make it better, but that doesn't diminish the fact that we could have played in that World Series and taking a shot at the title, and we're looking forward to finding a way to get back and putting ourselves in that type of position again, and hopefully, in a bat here or there, or a play here or there, make the difference. If we could fast forward into 2020.
Brian Cashman, Yankees senior VP and general manager, joins us on the Michael Kay Show. Now, you were kept from going to the World Series by the Astros this year, and in 2017, also by the Astros. And with the story in the Athletic that the Astros are using espionage to give signs and electronics and stuff like that, does that leave a bitter taste in your mouth, Brian?
That article broke yesterday. Timely. We were at the GM meetings here in Scottsdale, and our industry session had just concluded. and the article broke during the sessions, and we were collapsed right into our one-hour commitment that all GMs have to do for the national media,
right?
National and local media. So timing was interesting when that happened. So I took the I'm going to take the same approach I did yesterday. I think, you know, clearly this article has a lot of strong allegations with people putting their names to it. You know, Houston has responded with a statement saying that they'll take these allegations seriously, and with Major League Baseball involved, they will immediately start investigating this and cooperate fully. Clearly, it's on Major League Baseball's front burner now. Their antenna is up, and they will, you know, do their job and fully investigate. And I think based on all that, my best interest is no comment and rather not participate more in what's going to play out is, you know, a very, you know, concerning story.
All right.
You know.
Let me ask, follow up with this. I know I saw the story that you didn't want to comment, but I wanted to ask you, over the last couple of years, have the Yankees ever filed a grievance with Major League Baseball concerning the Astros?
I'm not going to comment on anything with this story currently or potential side stories. So obviously there's clearly someone has stepped up and more than one person has stepped up, former players, one with the Houston Astros and Fires put their name to it with some strong statements and, you know, I'll leave it at that. And, you know, Major League Baseball will, you know, pursue all areas, I'm sure, but again, it's in their area. You know, my job now is to try to put together the best team I possibly can as we move forward in 2020. Their job is to deal with issues that arise within the game that that distract or compromise the game. You know, when and if they come up, and that's not my job. It's in the hand. That's in the hands of the commissioner's office and their personnel. And so, I'm just not going to comment.
All right, where do we stand as far as you mentioned the starting pitching and addressing your rotation? Where does that begin? You're looking for a one or just basically all five and mix and match from there?
Well, you know, we'd like to have five ones, let alone one.
Right.
I saw one of Scott Boras' representatives yesterday and certainly checked in on Garrett Cole and Steven Strasburg, for instance. And, you know, I ran into the Mets former starter and Wheeler. I ran into his agent the other day, there's a lot of high-end guys, and there's guys that aren't as considered at that category but still could benefit your club. So we're checking the boxes by engaging the agents that represent, you know, all these type of players and then also talking to the available trade market and trying to see if we match up with anything with the opposing clubs that are in existence. So we'll see. But it's an area of focus for us, clearly. I mean, obviously, the innings are important. And as you see, too, going into 2020, we have two guys that are free agents at the end of the year in Tanaka and Paxton, too. You know, we're excited about Seve coming back. You know, we know he's one of the better pitchers in the American League from the starting rotation side. And we were denied his services for 80% of the season, it felt like. So hopefully we can follow that. This past season up with the real Seve coming back in the play for us and combine them with what we saw from Paxton the last 3 months of the season and get Jordan Montgomery, everybody saw him as a, you know, real crafty, tough left-hander. And Masa has always been what he's been. He's been a tremendous player for us since we brought him in from Japan. And if I can add to that and we get a bounce back from Hap, I think at the very least that's a starting point. And by improving upon it, you know, it would improve in theory our chances to obviously increase our odds to be the best we can possibly be, which is hopefully a world champ.
Because you're so good at what you do, obviously you are doing your due diligence on all these free agents, but I'm just wondering, they're not going to come cheap, especially the high-end guys. Do you have payroll constraints, Brian?
I mean, there's always a business component to everything you do. And if you were interviewing me at this particular time last year, obviously, you know, people were talking about Bryce Harper, they're talking about Manny Machado, and you know, we certainly were engaged with some of those high-end guys, and you don't know where they're going to lead. And our ownership gives us a lot of latitude, and they stay very directly involved every step of the way. But I would not have you know, at this stage, at last year, you know, the way these things play out, you kind of crawl through a lot of conversations with clubs and their agents. And that eventually led us to trading for Paxton, signing DJ LeMahieu, and signing Ottavino and Britton, to name a few of the moves we obviously made, and eventually in the spring doing Tauchman. Maybe some other things sprinkled in, but not much past that. But, the way these things emerge, they kind of organically grow into various conversations and touch points when you're engaged with these agents and clubs. And so I know the easy thing right now is to focus on some of the big names, and I promise you we'll be doing that. But we'll also be touching on some mid-level mm-hmm. and some lower unknowns that, you know, might, you know, manifest themselves into some interesting conversations down the line. Trust me, I know one thing. We are going to stay connected, get as much information as we can, provide as much information as we can to the opposing teams as well as agents, and then gravitate to what is the most realistic. Hal Steinbrenner and his owner and the Steinbrenner family has always provided us a wealth of opportunity to stay in almost all conversations. And I don't anticipate that changing. That doesn't guarantee certain results on certain individuals, but it does guarantee the engagement and interest levels will be there in the forefront, and they'll either strengthen or dissipate depending on how these conversations go and what the other alternative choices happen to be.
But you know, when it comes to a Strasburg or a Cole, that there's going to be teams out there that will go the extra mile to land these types of pitchers. So I guess the question becomes, I'm sure you have a budget. I'm sure you have what you believe every pitcher is worth. But how far out those constraints are you willing to go to be able to land pitchers of that high in elk?
You know, I don't think it's in my best interest to be transparent under those circumstances. And, you know, if I answered that in a positive way, you know, it only benefits the players and the agent. If I answer it in a negative way, I'm probably guilty of collusion or something. So, that's why I think it's just best for me to tell you we will be, as we always are, very diligent in our effort to improve our upon a 103-win team from 2019 and somehow, improve upon it and put it in a stronger position to, obviously defend the American League East first and foremost and find a way to get past all American League contenders to represent that, that league in the World Series. And then hopefully take that down. So somehow, some way, like always, that's the charge, that's the effort, and it's going to be a journey. So, hopefully it's sometime sooner than later we'll be in a position to at least introduce any new members that will be joining that effort. That would mean I'd be speaking to an acquisition via trade or free agent side, but obviously we're in the early stage of this thing. So it's going to have to play out, obviously, for a period of time.
How about your free agents? Are you close on Gardner? Do you have interest in bringing DD back?
I've talked to Guardy's agent multiple times. I've talked to Dee Dee's agent, who happens to be Dellen's agent as well. And he's got other players in the marketplace outside of us that might be of interest too. And that's Jim Murray's firm. So that, and it's Casey Close runs. So I'm checking all the boxes and staying in touch, having more conversations on certain subjects than others. But I'm not allowed to say who. Given the rules of the collective bargaining agreement.
And finally, you quoted in the papers today, it was very interesting about Andujar, that he could be a guy that you could move around. Where do you think his skill set allows you to play him? Could he play a middle infielder role? Do you think he could be an outfielder with his skills? We know he can hit, but how about defensively?
Yeah, that's the question at hand. I mean, in that media session that we had yesterday for an hour, I was responding to a very direct question of, hey, with Gio and how good he is, I mean, is there a chance for Andujar to maybe play elsewhere? And I acknowledged clearly that, yeah, it's something we played around daydreaming about a little bit. We haven't actually implemented anything on it. We haven't given him a first base glove, so to speak, or an outfield glove, so to speak, yet. Doesn't mean we won't. But the one thing about first Gio was at. It was a really tremendous season he had, both defensively and offensively at third, and he was a gift from God. So when we lost Miguel Andujar, Gio coming in and doing what he did was spectacular. And so, yeah, it's his position to lose. But that doesn't deny or allow us to forget how impactful Miguel Andujar was in 2018. Finishing second in the Rookie of the Year. He was a 23-year-old that posted an amazing OPS in his maiden voyage. So that's a bat that you'd want in the lineup. It reminds me of when we had Soriano pushing through. I think it was Jeter went down with a hamstring or something or a groin in spring training. And so for like 3 weeks, Soriano took the reps at short and was just so impactful with the bat, and that we were like, we got to find a way to get this guy in the lineup. And at first, I think he wound up in left field and eventually settled into second base. And his career took off, obviously, and was never to be denied since. Miggy is the type of offensive player that makes you daydream that way. All right, well, if Gio Urshela doesn't give this thing back, obviously we have flexibility to send Andujar to AAA, but should we look at him at first? Should we look at him in the outfield? I'm not saying we should. I just think we have to have the conversation. I think clearly the DJ LeMahieu experiment played out really well, having that versatility and flexibility for first, second, third, covered us in a lot of different ways, and so maybe Miggy covers us differently. I just don't know. It might not fit. I'm definitely getting a lot of interest in Miguel Andujar while I'm sitting out here. I've got clubs asking, hey, what are you going to do with him? We'd have an interest in him. Mark is down. So I think there's a whole array of opportunity and choices that we will be walking through as we navigate this winter. But first and foremost, we're looking for him to returning to health and getting back to what he does really well, which is play baseball. And he's an exciting young talent. And so how best to deploy that talent remains to be seen.